Hello everyone, my name is Thomas Karagiannis and I'm a principal researcher in the Cloud Infrastructure Group at Microsoft Research in Cambridge. In this talk, I will provide a brief description of Project Iris, which has been a multi-year effort at Microsoft Research exploring novel technologies for regional cloud networks. Traditionally, cloud scaling meant building mega data centers with hundreds of thousands of servers across the world and interconnecting them through a wide area network backbone. However, as the cloud expanded, it was apparent that there was a growing difficulty of sitting and provisioning large mega facilities in or near dense metro areas. This was due to limited resources such as land, power, and connectivity in many such areas. To alleviate resource limitations, instead of serving each broad geographic area from just one or two mega data centers, in many geographies, large cloud providers have transitioned to using a collection of smaller data centers within tens of kilometers of each other, referred to as a region. This was achieved by effectively breaking up the mega data center across smaller facilities that are now interconnected with what is referred to as a regional data center interconnect, or DCI for short. In essence, what used to be internal data center links within a few hundred meters are now externalized connections of a few tens of kilometers across a metropolitan area. The map shows how the geography of such a region of six data centers might look like in the metropolitan area of London. Small data center facilities are placed around a densely populated area. Inter-region connectivity is provided with the traditional wide area network backbone. Hyperscale cloud providers today feature tens of regions around the globe, and the overall impact of the shift to a regional architecture is evident when examining the number of deployed 100 gigabit ports over time, especially since they moved to the regional model. Overall, the growth has been exponential year over year, with a number of ports dominated by the regional connectivity by nearly two orders of magnitude compared to ports deployed in the WAN. It is thus not an exaggeration to say that DCI has become one of the most important pieces of the cloud puzzle. Now, how should a few data centers across a metropolitan area similar to London in the picture be interconnected? Let's have a quick look at the design space. The conceptually simplest way to interconnect regional data centers is a centralized topology. This approach uses a hub-and-spoke topology. Data centers in a region all connect to a centralized hub. There are no direct data center to data center connections, with all connectivity going through the hub. Hubs further provide connectivity to other regions through the wide area backbone. In the other extreme, a distributed approach removes the need for hubs and directly connects data centers to each other. This approach builds all pairs of data center to data center connections, and compared to the centralized approach that requires n connections, it needs n square links for n data centers. Such logical topologies would need to be implemented atop the existing fiber maps in the regions, with a picture showing how the logical designs of centralized and distributed topologies might be instantiated in the real physical topology. Of course, any approach in between these two extremes is also feasible. Semi-distributed topologies can cluster and connect data centers under local hubs. Hubs can then be interconnected to provide the full regional DCI. In Project Iris, we outlined the design space of DCI topologies based on data from Azure regions and physical layer testbed experiment across a variety of metrics. Our analysis shows that distributed topologies provide much lower data center to data center latency compared to centralized topologies as expected. This is due to the two-hop connectivity in centralized topologies where data centers need to communicate through the hub. While the latency advantage of direct data center to data center connectivity is unsurprising, we also saw that distributed topologies increase flexibility in terms of choosing data center sites. This is an important capital expense for cloud providers, and increasing the data center sitting area can provide significant benefits. The picture shows hypothetical regions based on real data, showing the size of the geographical area that is available for data centers to be built in centralized versus distributed topologies. These areas in both cases meet service level agreements on maximum allowed distances between data centers. The centralized topology area is highlighted with a light blue shade, with the blue arrows indicating the placement of the hubs. The yellow circles indicate the data centers. The existence of the hubs constrains the available area in the centralized topology. Instead, the extended gray area shows the available data center sitting area in case of distributed topologies. We find that depending on the region, the area in which new data centers could be built increases by 2 to 5 times with distributed topologies. Plotting a deployment flexibility curve together with a latency curve across the design space reveals that the ideal design point that minimizes latency and maximizes flexibility is towards fully distributed topologies. However, similar analysis, just based on the number and cost of electrical ports required to interconnect data centers in a distributed topology, reveals that a distributed design for a sample region of 16 data centers can be as much as 7 times more expensive compared to a centralized design. Similarly, it is more complex due to the N-square connectivity, adding 14 times the number of ports. Given this, let's have another look at the design space. Plotting the cost and complexity curves provide a preferred operational point in the other extreme of the design space, namely centralized topologies. In fact, the cost and complexity of the fully distributed topology can even render this space practically infeasible despite the latency and flexibility benefits. So, how can we reconcile this trade-off across metrics? Looking at today's physical connectivity in the region, this follows the typical point-to-point optical links. A number of transceivers at each end of a link perform optical to electrical to optical conversions and are packed into single-mode fibers. The biggest contributor to the cost in DCI is the number of ports and transceivers per fiber. In all, assuming 40 channels per fiber, as is typically the case in DCI, we would need 40 ports per end transceivers per fiber end per switching point. This results in a quadratic increase of the cost and complexity as the topology becomes more and more distributed. To reduce this cost, in IRIS, we advocate the use of optical switching at the fiber granularity. This replaces all 40 transceivers at one end of the link and all electrical ports with a single passive optical port. This is a huge reduction in cost and complexity as seen from the number of ports and components that need to be managed. Unfortunately, moving from electrical to optical switches is not a trivial one-to-one replacement. First, as we move from traditional packet switching and switching at the granularity of a fiber, we introduce capacity loss into the network. Second, amplifiers affect the optical signal-to-noise ratio, and without regeneration, not enough OSNR budget is present end-to-end. Third, while we can limit the number of amplifiers end-to-end, this then penalizes the power budget, as optical switches and the extended fiber reach can add power loss. Finally, a reconfigurable physical layer architecture based on optical switching implies a physical layer control plane. This control plane would need to control the power of each individual physical component if applied naively. While the previous problems appear to focus on the physical layer, to truly unlock the benefits of the whole design space, we actually need to jointly solve a range of problems across a wide spectrum and across layers that are actually interdependent. These include challenges like topology design to meet service level agreements, capacity to provide non-blocking connectivity, and resilience to ensure SLAs are preserved despite failures. These problems could be considered as traditional networking problems. On the other hand, the bottom row specifies the physical layer challenges discussed. These typically would be addressed by optics communities such as OFC. IRIS takes a cross-layer design to jointly solve these challenges, and this is what allows us to provide an architecture that reduces the cost and complexity of distributed topologies. This allows us to move from a design space where distributed topologies are practically infeasible due to cost and complexity, to an architecture that can make the whole design space feasible. It is then up to the provider to weigh the pros and cons of centralized and distributed topologies and pick the one that best fits their deployment models and business purposes. The work in the IRIS project resulted in rethinking the whole architecture and physical layer, which we implemented and emulated at a small scale in our lab at Cambridge. The picture shows part of our lab. The IRIS architecture does not require an analog control plane, significantly lowering the bar for deployment, and our analysis shows that this is feasible with truly minimal performance impact. In summary, IRIS is a novel, all-optical DCI architecture that unlocks the advantages of distributed topologies while lowering cost and complexity. The IRIS DCI architecture was possible thanks to insights across layers and thanks to the optics for the cloud team at Microsoft Research in Cambridge. To find out more details, please take a look at our paper. Thank you for watching.